Hello and welcome to today's lecture, Introduction to Rocket Science. I'm your lecturer, your host, Dr. Simon Foster, and I'm a space scientist at Imperial College, London. And in today's lecture, we're going to learn about the basics of rocketry, of rocket science. And hopefully by the end of the lecture, you'll understand the key features of launching human beings into space using rockets. Now, when many of us think about rocket scientists, we think about astronauts and pictures and people like you can see on the screen now. Okay, I believe this is an astronaut, Alan Shepard, on the moon. However, when you think about astronauts, what you should really think of is people like this. And this is me when I was a little boy. It's hard to believe. I can see I've got black hair now. Back then I had blonde hair. But rocket scientists don't start out as adults. We don't start out as rocket scientists. We start out as children and young people with dreams. And I dreamt of being a space scientist. I dreamt of being an astronaut. Unfortunately, that didn't happen. But I was very lucky. And I went to university and I studied astronautics, rocket science at university. And then I studied for a PhD in space science. And if I can do it, hopefully you'll be able to do it as well. Okay, so if you ever wonder what a rocket scientist looks like, look in the mirror, because you can be a rocket scientist. You are a rocket scientist, okay? So I'm going to start this lecture by asking you a question, okay? So I want you to think about, and you can ask your friends and you know, debate amongst yourselves, but when did human beings first try to launch themselves into space using rockets? Now, was it in 0 AD, you know, over 2000 years ago? Was it around 1783, okay, which is about, trying to do some maths, about 240 years ago? Or was it in 1961, about 60 years ago, okay? Have a quick think. And then see if you can kind of see amongst your peers, your friends in the room there, who thinks what. Okay, so put your hands up for A, 2000 years ago. Put your hands up for B, about 240 years ago. And put your hands up for C, 60 years ago, 1961. Okay, hopefully you've all answered. This may amaze you, but human beings first tried to launch themselves into space using rockets over 2,000 years ago. And this was the birth of rocketry, of rocket science. So let's have a look at that. Okay, so basically, the main important thing about rocket science is thrust, the fuel. Okay, the bigger the fuel, the better the fuel, the heavier the rocket, the heavier the payload we can launch up into space. And this is the start of everything. And the ancient Chinese, they actually discovered gunpowder, or the recipe for gunpowder, rocket fuel, basically, over 2,000 years ago. Some records say that it might have even been 3,000 years ago. And the picture on the screen now is from a Chinese book called the I Ching. And it was like an encyclopedia, okay? And in it, they have the recipe for gunpowder. In this picture here, you can actually see the Big Dipper. So the ancient Chinese, thousands of years ago, had lots of knowledge about astronomy, science, and space. And this is how we make gunpowder. This is the ingredients for gunpowder, or rocket fuel. It's sulfur, and sometimes you can smell sulfur in rotten eggs, sulfur dioxide, when eggs go off. You know, you get that horrible smell. That's when sulfur's reacted with oxygen. Okay, so sulfur's all around us. Very easy to find. You can find it, you can get sulfur mines. The next ingredient is something called saltpeter, or potassium nitrate. Okay, and this is used to preserve foods. So if you've ever heard of salt beef, salt fish, anything like that, it's actually a preservative that's used on foods. And the last ingredient is charcoal. So if you've ever had a barbecue, anything like that, it's a fuel source, okay? And the saltpeter basically makes the reacts with that charcoal and releases all that energy in the charcoal very quickly. So on a barbecue, all that energy is from the charcoal is released slowly to cook your food. But if you can release it quickly in a flash, then you get, I suppose, an explosion or fuel, and that can launch a rocket. So these are actually the ratios you need to make gunpowder. Okay, not that I'm saying you should do this, but if you took a teaspoon or anything, you take 1 teaspoon of charcoal, 3 teaspoons of saltpeter, and 1/2 teaspoon of sulfur, that just gets the reaction going quicker. That's basically the recipe for gunpowder. Now, when you put it in a bowl, you could have big lumps, okay, like you can see on the screen. So if you ever used a pestle and mortar, it's like a grinder for grinding salt and peppercorn or herbs. This is what the ancient Chinese did. They would take these big lumps of charcoal, sulfur, saltpeter, grind it up into smaller balls, smaller lumps like you can see here, and that made the reaction happen quicker and easier. Okay, so when you mix this together, you've got rocket fuel, gunpowder. Now, if you place this into a sealed container where the gases that are created, the smoke, cannot escape, that's when you have gunpowder or a bomb. And so this video is going to show that now. So we'll play the video now. So what you can see there is that when the gunpowder is lit and it's in a sealed container and all those that heat and gas can't escape, then you get an uncontrolled release of that energy and you get an explosion. However, if instead of that you place a hole in that container through which the gases and heat can escape, instead of having a bomb or an explosion, you have a rocket. You can use that energy, that smoke, to produce thrust, and with that you can launch a rocket. And what you can see here in this video is fireworks. That just uses gunpowder. They still use that. We call it solid rocket fuel. And as you can see here, if we play the video, you can see the heat and the gas escaping through the bottom and the rocket's launched. So we'll play that video. So there you can see that's basically the difference between gunpowder and rocket fuel. If you can allow the gas to escape safely, then you have a rocket. And rockets work because of this, or work basically, the principles behind rocketry work because of this famous scientist. Now, I wonder if any of you can have a quick guess amongst your peers, your friends there, if you can work out who this famous scientist is. Okay, have a quick think. His name is Sir Isaac Newton. And actually, he came up with his laws of motion. You may have heard of them. He had 3 laws of motion. And he actually came up with them during a pandemic. He was working at Oxford, I believe. Oxford or Cambridge, I should know. Actually, it was Cambridge. Cambridge University. And he had to go home because there was the plague on at the time in Britain. And he worked at home and he came up with 3 laws of motion. Now, the most important one for rocketry, for what we need to know, is this, Newton's 3rd law of motion. And that states, for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. Now, what does this really mean? Well, basically, it means if you have a push in one direction, you have a push in the opposite direction. Okay, if you think about it, if you've ever been on roller skates or a skateboard or anything like that, if I push in that direction, I'll move backwards. Okay, so you have action, reaction. Okay, and it's as simple as that. So here, as you can see in this picture, when our heat and gas escapes through the bottom of the rocket, it pushes down. Well, you have a push down. What must you get to counter that? You have a push in the opposite direction. So you have a big push down, you have a big push up. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. This is the basics of rocketry. So the bigger the push down, the better the fuel, the more powerful the fuel, the bigger the push up. So rocket scientists are always looking for more powerful fuels and how to use them. It doesn't always mean that the most powerful fuels are the best fuels, though. Okay, so I need to stress that. Okay, because they can be quite too explosive, they can be quite dangerous. So going back to our astronaut, our first rocket scientist, his name was Wan Hu. And he took 36 of these rockets, because the Chinese have fireworks, and placed them around a chair. And he launched them. And according to these Chinese records, he disappeared in a puff of smoke, never to be seen again. Now, we'll leave it at that, whether or not it was a success. The Chinese insist it was a success. No one really repeated the experiment at the time, so it makes me think it may not have gone too well. But that's the first recorded attempt of someone trying to use rockets to launch themselves into space or into the atmosphere. However, there was a man in 1633, I believe it was, called Lagari Hasan Salibi, and he was, I believe he was Turkish. He lived in the Ottoman Empire, and it was a Turkish Empire in the Middle East. And he went to the Sultan's, I believe it was the Sultan's birthday party, and he performed a trick there. He took what you can see is effectively a metal dustbin, and he placed a lot of rockets down the bottom of it and launched himself into the air as a kind of treat for the Sultan's birthday. Apparently it worked. He launched himself into the bay of Istanbul, into the water. The rocket launched, he came down in the water, and he survived. And the Sultan was so impressed, he gave him some money and some lands. So Lagari Salibi is potentially the first person that survived a rocket launch, okay? But that people have been trying for a long, long time to launch themselves into space. Now, the rockets really took off, sorry for a bad joke there, in about 1950, okay, when we had something called the Cold War. And that was between the United States of America and the Soviet Union, effectively Russia. And the Cold War was called the Cold War because the two countries or the two systems didn't get on. But instead of fighting each other with weapons, they fought each other with ideas and science. And one of those scientific ideas they tried to battle on was space. Getting into space, the first human being in space, the first rocket, the first satellite, the first people on the moon. Again, this was a huge battle between the United States and the Soviet Union, and to do that they needed bigger and better rockets. So the first rocket that was really made was actually down here in the corner. It was called the V2, and that was actually developed in World War II by the Germans, and a lot of them bombed the United Kingdom. Where I live in London, there's V2 sites where V2 rockets with bombs inside landed, and my nan can remember this happening. My grandmother can remember this happening. So down here we have the V2, tiny, and up here this big one over here, I can hopefully wave there. This is called the Saturn V, and this is the rocket that took human beings to the moon. And what's amazing about this is only this tiny little bit, can you see that bit there? Only that tiny little bit at the top actually had two human beings in and the spacecraft that went to the moon. All the rest of this is fuel, which is unbelievable. Okay, all of that there, sorry, I went too far. All of that is fuel. So most of a rocket is fuel and engines. Isn't that incredible? Now, I spoke earlier about bigger and better fuels, and this is what we need. But part of the problem with bigger and better fuels is that they're explosive. And you can see here, this is a really, really, really powerful fuel that the Soviet Union investigated. But as you're going to see in this video, look how destructive and powerful it is. So look at this video. Now you can see there that that's a tiny drop. It actually uses acid to get working as what we call a catalyst to start the reaction. It's far too dangerous. So that is a really explosive and powerful fuel, but it's too dangerous to use, okay? So this is part of the problem with being a rocket scientist. You have to find rocket fuels which by their design are explosive, but you kind of have to find safe ones, which is very difficult. We can actually use water as fuel. Now that sounds very peculiar. Water as rocket fuel? Water puts out fires. But water is made up of two elements, and you may have heard of this, H2O. That's a chemical formula for water. And what that means is water is made up of two elements, hydrogen, the H, two hydrogen atoms, and one oxygen atom, the O. And you can see a picture of it here. Now, what's interesting is the hydrogen in H2O in water is actually slightly positive, and the oxygen is slightly negatively charged. And that's super important and useful. Why? Well, you may have heard the phrase opposites attract. For example, the north and the south poles of a magnet push together, okay, will join together, and sorry, and the north and north or south and south poles of the magnet will push apart. So opposites attract. North and south clunk, or positive and negative clunk will push together, pull together. So what we can use electricity. Believe it or not, we can use electricity to pull water apart to make hydrogen, which you can see here is positively charged, and that's attracted to the negative part of the electricity. And oxygen, here it's the blue, the negatively charged bits, we're attracted to the positive part of our electric source. And we can make hydrogen gas and oxygen gas. Why is that important? Well, I've put it in here. So here's a clip of me dropping a battery, a 9-volt battery that's got a positive and a negative terminal, into some water. And what you'll be able to see is that actually, can you see some bubbles forming? Hopefully you'll be able to see some bubbles forming. That's a hydrogen on one terminal and the oxygen on the other. We're making rocket fuel just from water. So hopefully you'll be able to see that in this clip. Now, if we collect that hydrogen, we don't need to worry about the oxygen because the oxygen's all around us. We breathe oxygen. But if we collect that hydrogen, as I have here in this balloon, and ignite it, you'll see what happens. So I've collected that hydrogen, placed it in a balloon. It's only a small amount of hydrogen. And I'm igniting it in this video. And let's see what happens. Now, you should be able to see that as I light the splint and getting closer, there should be a nice explosion. So you've seen there that by igniting that hydrogen, we get a big explosion. We've got rocket fuel. It's easy to make. We can make it from water. And that's the really cool thing. Okay, so rocket fuel can be made. A lot of rocket fuel now is made from water. And if we go to Mars or the Moon and there's water there, we can turn that water into rocket fuel to come back from Mars or the Moon to Earth. We don't need to take the fuel with us. Now, going back to our space race, the Soviet Union were the first people to get a satellite into space. And it transmitted a radio signal, which you can hear in this radio clip. Now, it just sounds like beep, 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 not a problem. However, to Americans tuning in on their radio, this was devastating. It really shocked them because the Soviet Union, who they thought were technologically very, very way behind them, had launched a satellite into space. What else could they do? So the Americans thought, right, we need to get the first human being into space or the first human being onto the moon. But launching human beings is very different to launching a satellite. A satellite is a piece of metal. The satellite explodes or doesn't get into space, it's not really that much of a problem. But human beings, obviously, we're soft and squishy, we're very delicate, and launching human beings into space presents a lot of problems. One of which is something called G-force. Now, G-force just means gravity force. And if you've ever been in a car or on a train or on a bus, you'll know that as you speed up, you get pulled back. And it's artificial gravity. You just feel it in a car or in a bus. But going onto a rocket into space, you need to accelerate up to 11,000 meters a second. That's 11 kilometers a second. So to accelerate up to that, you're going to feel a lot of G-force. And this puts a lot of strain on the human body. Now, to test astronauts, we spin them around in something like this. This is called a centrifuge. It's a bit like a roundabout that you've been on at a playground. Astronauts are spun around. I mean, the ones that cope with it best go through to the next round, might become astronauts. And what's really interesting is that in this clip here, you can see astronauts inside the centrifuge. Now, up in the top right-hand corner, you'll be able to see it says G. That's a G-force the astronauts are feeling. And they're holding on to what's called a dead man's stick. And all that means is that if they feel ill or they pass out, they let go of that stick, the centrifuge stops spinning, okay, and they're fine. Because what happens in the centrifuge, as you're seeing in this video, is that the blood, because you're moving so fast, the blood gets pulled down from your head, okay, to your feet. Without blood going to your brain, you can pass out. It's called G-lock, gravitational induced loss of consciousness.
I got a stick. On top, breathe. You're on top, breathe.
I'm doing the danger.
Big breath, watch out and
hold it.
You're on top, breathe.
Oh. On top, breathe.
1, 2, 3.
1, 2, 3. No shield breath.
1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3.
Right?
No.
Legs tight. Butt tight. Breathe.
1, 2, 3.
1, 2. Well, okay. Stay tight. Hello? Are you with me? You coming back around? Hello? How you doing?
What?
Hello, Will?
Hello.
Will, sit up.
I'm up.
Sit up.
I'm up.
Sit up.
Yes.
Put your head up.
It is up.
Put your head up.
Oh.
Do you know what happened?
Yeah.
You ate lock.
Yeah.
Happened?
I was taking the IG lock.
All right.
Okay, you alright? You feel nauseated?
Yeah, a little bit. I'm gonna vomit.
Okay, get the bag. Get the bag.
It was a big jerky.
I actually have no comment for you. Everything looked real good. How you feel? Woo! Good job.
So your heart has to work harder to pump the blood to your brain, and it's very hard to breathe because your chest is squished, so you can see the astronaut taking short sharp breaths because it's really hard to breathe normally. So this is all part of the astronaut training process, and you can also see at the end of the video that you've got a squishy bag of stuff in your stomach. That's food. Unfortunately, you can be sick as well. So when you're training astronauts, you want them to have strong heart, lung, and stomachs. Now, the Russian found such a man. His name was Yuri Gagarin. And on the 12th of April 1961, so it was 60 years ago, in 1961, human beings first got an astronaut into space, a cosmonaut, and his name was Yuri Gagarin. Fantastic human being. Very strong. He had a strong heart, strong stomach, luckily. He was a test pilot for the Soviet Air Force. So this really upset the Americans, because now not only did the Soviet Union get the first satellite into space, they had the first astronaut. You can think of it as a game of football. The Soviet Union were 2-0 up. So the Americans decided they had to do something, and they decided they had to get astronauts onto the moon. But getting astronauts onto the moon is an even bigger challenge than just getting them into space. Part of the problem is that space is a vacuum. There's no air there, okay? And things behave very strangely in space, in a vacuum. So things that were how we take things normally on Earth don't behave the same in a vacuum, okay? One of these things is air, because air will always go from when there's more of it to where there's less of it. Okay, and because space is a vacuum, there's no air there. There's lots of pressure on our spaceship. All the air inside our spaceship is trying to push out and escape. Now, this can be seen, a good example can be seen here in our balloon. So if we play the video, what you can see is here, this is inside. I've placed a balloon inside a vacuum chamber, and I've turned the vacuum chamber on. And all the air surrounding the balloon in that vacuum chamber is being removed. And look what happens to the balloon. It starts to inflate. It's going from where there's lots of air to where there's less air, and it's trying to push out. And obviously the astronauts on the moon in a spacesuit, their spacesuit's going to have to cope with that pressure as well, because all the air inside their spacesuit is going to want to push out. So they not only had to come up with spacecraft, they had to come up with spacesuits that could cope in the vacuum of space. Now, it's not just air that can pose a problem in space. Believe it or not, water can too. And human beings, us, we're about 70% water. Your blood is nearly all water. We're big bags of water. Water behaves really peculiarly in a vacuum, which you can see here. So I'm going to start this video And what you'll be able to see is, so basically this is water at room temperature. It's about 20 degrees. Okay, this is in my old lab. And you can see it here. This is water in here at 20 degrees. And I'm taking the air out from around it inside the vacuum chamber. And look what happens to the water. So hopefully you'll be able to see it starts to boil. It's bubbling away. That's because when there's less air pushing down on the water, it needs less energy, less heat to boil. And in space, believe it or not, water can boil at about 20 degrees. Now your blood is about 30 degrees, 36 degrees, I think, to be precise. So the problem in space is your water, your blood inside your body can literally boil. In a vacuum, lots of air bubbles will get there. So we need to create spacesuits, spacecraft that ensure our human beings remain nice and safe. Now, the other big problem about space is it's very cold. Okay, regions of space can be as cold as minus 270 degrees Celsius. That's basically nearly what we call absolute zero, as cold as you can possibly get. Absolute zero is about minus 273 degrees. Okay, now to give you an idea, the coldest places on Earth are about minus 50 degrees. I've been to a place in Russia that was minus 28. That was very, very cold. But as you can manage, on the moon, I believe you can get down to minus 100 degrees. That's incredibly cold. And obviously for the human body, that's a big problem. As you'll be able to see in this video. So what I've got in this container here is something called liquid nitrogen. Now, liquid nitrogen, nitrogen's a gas all around us, okay? And liquid nitrogen is minus 200 degrees, okay? So the liquid inside this container is minus 200 degrees, and you'll be able to see that I've placed inside that banana, okay? So the banana is soft and squishy like the human body. And when placed inside the liquid nitrogen, it's going to go down to at least minus 100 degrees, around about minus 200 degrees, which is the same temperature as you're going to find on the moon. Okay, so let's see what happens to our banana. Basically the same as the human body.
Move it that way a little. Oh, no, yeah, it's in shot, yeah, it's in shot.
Okay, so what you can see there is that the human body, the banana, becomes incredibly brittle, incredibly fragile if exposed to the extreme temperatures of space. So we need a spacesuit that not only keeps the air in and stops it escaping, we need a spacesuit that regulates temperature as well. And that's why you have these huge spacesuits on the moon. And that's why you can see here with this astronaut, Alan Shepard, his spacesuit here is so big and bulky because A, it's trying to keep the air in. But this thing on the back here, can you see they've got these huge backpacks? That doesn't just keep, that isn't just produce air for the astronauts to breathe. It's actually regulating his temperature. A lot of it is a heater to keep the astronaut warm. I used to think it was big oxygen tanks. It's not, only a small amount of it is air. The main part of it is a heater to stop the astronauts getting too hot, and actually it can cool them down as well, because if the sun's blazing down, they can also get too hot. Now, in 1969, the Americans, the United States of America, got astronauts on the moon. Buzz Aldrin, Neil Armstrong, and Michael Collins circled around the moon in a spacecraft to bring them home. So effectively, it was such a monumental feat, such an amazing thing, the United States of America won the space race. Okay, and it kind of ended there, which is a shame. America went back to the moon another 5 times. Okay, but we haven't been back since 1972. Astronauts are going to go back to the moon soon, and then on to Mars. And it's people of your age that could be the next lot of people that land on the moon, and certainly one of you, it'd be people of your age that are going to be the first people to walk on Mars. And that really excites me, because you could be the first person to land on Mars. Okay, think about that. If you want to do it, you can try. Please try. Work hard in school. You know, have a dream, and it could be you. You could be the first person to land on Mars, and I would have the great honour of being able to say that I once spoke to the first human being to land on Mars. So, we will end the lecture there. Congratulations, you now understand the basics of rocket science. You are rocket scientists yourself. And I believe we will now have some, you can pose some questions to me, and I will now join you, yes, for the questions and answers. So thank you very much for listening. It's been my pleasure, and I look forward to speaking to you. Thank you.
طبعا مرحبا بكل اللي معنا حاليا ان شاء الله تكون انبسطتوا بالفيديو وهلا رح نبدا مثل ما قلنا معنا الدكتور سايمون هلا رح يطلع معنا ورح نبدا ناخذ اسئلتكم هاي وصلنا كثير من اسئلتكم واللي لسه عنده كمان اسئله فيه يبعثها على الكيو ان اي بتلاقوه تحت بالزوم فيكم تبعثوا الأسئلة باللغة العربية أو باللغة الإنجليزية وطبعاً رح نحاول نجاوب على كل الأسئلة هلا. دكتور سايمون, thanks for being with us today.
Hello everyone. Hopefully, can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Excellent.
Yeah. So we've got many questions today for this.
Brilliant.
Seems like exciting. Yeah, so here I've got many questions about the fuel, and maybe we can start with this one. Is the water safer than the other fuels or more dangerous? Also we can talk about the best fuel to use for a rocket. This is another question. So I'll just say this question in Arabic and get back to you to get your answer.
Great.
طيب هلا طبعا في كثير اسئله بعثوا لنا اياها، رح نحاول انه يعني نجاوب على اغلب الاسئله او كلها. نبدا في اسئله عندي الحقيقه كانت تسال عن وقود الصواريخ وشو هو افضل وقود. في كان سؤال بيقول انه هل استخدام الماء هو امن من استخدام بقيه الوقود، الانواع الاخرى من الوقود، وايضا شو هو افضل نوع من الوقود يمكن استخدامه بالصواريخ. فرح نرجع للدكتور سايمون ونشوف اجابته. دكتور سايمون، back to you.
Hello, firstly can I just say thank you very much for having me and joining the lecture today. It's a real pleasure to be able to speak to you and answer your questions. So the first question about using water or hydrogen as fuel. Now, the main advantage of using water or separating it into hydrogen and oxygen is that it's quite easy to do that. It's quite easy to produce.
All right. فهوني كبداية الحقيقة أول ميزة إن استخدام الماء إنه هو من السهل إيجاده، من السهل التعامل معه. الماء موجودة، ما في داعي نحن نستخرجها أو يكون عندنا وصفة لا. الماء موجودة وبسهولة ممكن الحصول عليه. Back to you, Dr. Simon.
Thank you. So it's easy to make, and luckily when you ignite it, the two products, the waste that you get out, is just going to be water. So as your rocket takes off, all that's coming out of the back of it is steam. So it's not toxic and it's not dangerous. And actually, it is very powerful. Over to you, Nazeer.
كمان الميزة الثانية انه لما بيحترق الهيدروجين بيحترق المي، المخلفات اللي نحن بنحصل عليها هي عبارة عن بخار المي، يعني بيطلع عنا فقط بخار. فهذا البخار اكيد هو ما بيكون خطر، ما بيكون حتى ما بيكون سام كمان، ما هي مخلفات ضارة في البيئة. فهي كمان احد ميزات استخدام الماء كوقود. Back to you, Dr. Simon.
But there are more powerful fuels. So a really good one is actually methane gas. So this is what we use to cook with and things like that. Methane gas, when we go to Mars, is going to be very important because you can take hydrogen, which you can make from the water on Mars, and combine it with the carbon dioxide that's present on Mars and make methane gas. And that's more powerful than water. And so for a smaller rocket, which you will land on Mars, you will need a slightly more powerful fuel to take off. And so actually it would appear that methane would be a great fuel, but it is slightly harder to make.
But that is because Mars has like more gravity and needs like bigger escape velocity. Is
that... No, Mars actually has a lower gravity. But the problem is when you go to Mars, a lot of the rocket will be discarded. So when you go to Mars and land, you're actually going to land in a smaller vehicle. It's a bit like the lander that landed on the moon. So the thing that actually lands on Mars is actually going to be the escape from Mars as well. And it's going to be quite small. And so because it's a lot smaller, it needs to have a more powerful fuel, if that makes sense, to lift back off. Those rocket engines are going to need a more powerful thrust. Hopefully that makes sense.
Yes. Okay, let me
sorry.
Talk to other students and yeah, I'll get back to you on that. طيب هلا بيقول طبعا الدكتور هل هو يعني بالنسبه للمي انه هل هي افضل وقود للصواريخ؟ الحقيقه في الاقوى اللي بيعطي قوه اكبر اللي هو غاز الميثين. غاز الميثين اللي بنستخدمه في الطبخ. فهذا الغاز هذا ممكن يعطينا قوه اكثر من الماء. ولكن طبعا استخدام الماء باعتباره امن. ولكن احنا ممكن بيقول الدكتور انه ممكن احنا نحتاج لانه نستخدم وقود الميثين لما نكون على مارس على المريخ. فلما نطلع على المريخ الرجوع من هناك ممكن يحتاج وقود اكبر، وهذا ما له علاقه. انا سالت الدكتور انه اذا هذا له علاقه بانه جاذبيه المريخ اكبر، عم يقول جاذبيه المريخ هي اقل، ولكن هذا له علاقه ببعض التقنيات اللي بتحتاجها المركبه هناك، باعتبار هي المركبه راح تكون اصغر، محرك اصغر، فراح يحتاج وقود اكبر لحتى وقود بقوه اكبر لحتى يقدر يطلع من مجال جاذبيه المريخ، وبالتالي ممكن استخدام غاز الميثان. والشيء اللي ممكن نحن نعمله انه طبعا استخدام الماء هون لما يوصل الصاروخ لهنيك على المريخ، في عنا ثاني اكسيد الكربون، غاز ثاني اكسيد الكربون موجود على المريخ مع الماء اللي راح تحمله السفينه من هون، ممكن خلطهم سوا، وهدول لما نخلطهم سوا ممكن يعطونا غاز الميثان اللي ممكن تستخدمه سفينه الفضاء للرجوع من المريخ. Back to you, Dr. Simon.
Hopefully, I think that may have answered the question. I hope, Nazeer.
Yeah. So yeah, we can go to the to other questions.
Brilliant.
هذا كان جوابه للدكتور على سؤال إنه هل الماء آمن أو هو يعني أحسن من بقية الوقود؟ نعم. وأيضا شو هو أفضل وقود؟ نعم، الماء مفضل ولكن في أقوى منه لو احتجنا أقوى. رح ناخذ سؤال ثاني من اسئلتكم. So here, what is the best subject to study to become an astronaut?
That's an excellent question.
Right? Yeah, I'll also just say that question to our students and get back to you. طيب في عندنا هون سؤال، هي كمان سؤال حلو، انه شو هو افضل موضوع انه نحن نركز على دراسته لو ردنا نصير من رواد الفضاء؟ Back to you, Dr. Simon.
The great answer is that there's no subject that is kind of not useful when becoming an astronaut, especially in the area of science. So when we go to Mars, we're going to need botanists, biologists, botanists to grow plants and food, and biologists to look for signs of ancient life. We're going to need chemists, engineers, physicists, medics, because if someone becomes ill on the journey, they will need treatment. So actually, any subject of science, and including also geography, geology, because we need to understand the planet itself, all of those are great subjects to prepare yourself to be an astronaut. So actually there's lots of different routes. I hope that helps. Sorry, Nazeer.
Yeah,
I'll get back to you.
Yeah. It's good. So طبعا نحن كان سؤالنا انه عن شو افضل ماده انه الشخص يدرسها في حال كان يعني في حال حابب يصير رائد فضاء. فعم بيقول انه افضل جواب هون الدكتور سامي عم بيقول انه ما في عندنا ماده هي ما مفيده لرائد الفضاء، يعني لما تكون رائد فضاء كل المواد راح تكون مفيده. كمثال عم يعطي انه نحن لما نطلع على المريخ بيلزمنا علماء نبات لحتى يعرفوا شو ممكن يصير هناك، شو النباتات اللي ممكن تكون هناك، بيلزمنا علماء احياء، بلزمنا علماء الجغرافيا، فكل حتى طبعا الاطباء بيعرفوا بالعلوم الصحيه، لانه لو الطاقم تعب مثلا هناك ممكن كمان يعتنوا فيه. فكل المجالات وكل الكورسات هي مهمه لعلماء او لحتى للشخص اللي بده يكون رائد فضاء. Okay, back to you, Dr. Simon. That was it, I think.
I think that's it, basically. So yeah. Yes, all subjects, science and areas are very useful. Yeah.
All right. I'll, yeah. So we'll move to the next question, I think. طيب طبعا هذا كان جواب الدكتور سايمون على سؤال المواد، وحاليا راح ننتقل للسؤال الثاني. طيب في عندنا هون سؤال، ليش الفضاء بيكون بارد جدا؟ حكينا عن البرودة بالفضاء وانه هو تقريبا في اماكن عم بتكون قريبه من درجه حراره الصفر المطلق اللي هي ناقص 273. ففي عندنا هون سؤال انه ليش الفضاء بيكون بارد بالرغم من وجود كثير من النجوم، من وجود الشموس، الشمس حاره جدا، فليش الفضاء بيكون بارد؟ So we have here really intriguing question, and I said the question in Arabic. I'll just say the question now. So why does space, or why is a space cold? Like while there is a lot of stars and suns in it.
Oh, why is it cold? Right, actually, sorry, is that the question? Why is space cold?
Yeah.
Right. Exactly. Effectively, the reason is there's nothing to hold on to the heat. The Earth stays warm because sunlight comes down, warms the ground. And then of a night, when the sun isn't there to warm the atmosphere, the ground gives that heat back off. And also, the atmosphere, the chemicals in it, such as carbon dioxide and water, behave like a blanket for the Earth. And so it traps heat. Now in space, there's no ground, there's no atmosphere. So nothing's there to trap the heat. So energy just passes straight through. I hope that makes sense. Is that okay, Nazeer?
Yeah, so it's like there is heat from the sun and the stars, but there is nothing to hold on it.
Yes, yeah. Effectively,
that does make sense, yeah. طيب بالنسبة لهذا السؤال، السؤال اللي إنه ليش الفضاء بارد رغم في شمس، في 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 نجوم، فليش في عندنا ليش هالبرودة، ليش هي درجة حرارة باردة؟ صح عم بيقول دكتور سايمون، عم بيقول صح في عندنا نحن النجوم اللي والشمس اللي اصلا هي اللي عم تسخن الارض، ولكن بالفضاء ما في شيء يحتفظ بالحراره، يعني الحراره بتجي ولكن ما في شيء يحتفظ فيها. على الارض نحن الارض بتحتفظ بالحراره، الارض جوا حار بسبب الغلاف الجوي اللي موجود حواليها. فلولا هذا الغلاف الجوي الارض بتكون بارده، الارض لما عم تجي حراره الشمس عم تسقط على الارض، عم تنعكس من الارض، لما تنعكس عم يحتفظ فيها الغلاف الجوي، ما كل الـ يعني الحرارة عم تهرب من الأرض. فالسبب أنه الفضاء بارد، السبب أنه لا يوجد شيء يحتفظ بالحرارة اللي عم تجي من الشمس والنجوم. So I think also that was the answer, right?
Do you yes.
have anything to that? Okay.
Can I just point out, just to show this as an example, this is effectively, as you go higher up in the atmosphere, it gets colder. Now, because my nephew asked me this, he said, why if you get closer to the sun, does it not get warmer? And it's right. Because as you go higher up, the ground, does that make sense, warms you around. Does that, it's like putting a stone in the fire. When you take the stone out, it stays hot and gives off that heat. So when you go up in the atmosphere, you get further from that stone and you get colder and colder. Sorry, I thought I'd just add that at the end. I hope that's okay, Nazeer.
Well, that's a good clarification. Yeah, I'll also...
Thank you.
Yeah, I'll deliver that. طيب تمام، بس إضافة كمان على الجواب إنه نحن يعني الحرارة الحقيقة بتجي من انعكاسها من الأرض، فلهذا السبب بنلاقي إنه نحن لما نكون قريبين على الأرض بيكون حرارة أكبر من لما نرتفع عن سطح الأرض. لما نطلع بالغلاف الجوي للأعلى هون الاحتفاظ بالحرارة بصير أقل وبتصير هون أبرد، وهذا السبب عم بيقول. طبعا سأله ابن اخوه للدكتور مره انه ليش نحن كل ما بعدنا عن الارض المفروض عم نقرب من الشمس، فالمفروض انه يكون اسخن، فكان طبعا الجواب احد الاسباب انه الأرض لما تجي الحرارة عليها عم تحتفظ فيها، فالأماكن الأقرب من الأرض هي اللي بتكون حرارتها أكبر. كل ما بعدنا عن الأرض كل ما خف الغلاف الجوي، كل ما صار الاحتفاظ بالحرارة أقل. Yes, so I think we can move to the next question, right?
Okay, yep.
Alright. طيب رح ننتقل لسؤال لسؤال ثاني. إنه في سؤال هون عن الصينيين، حكى الدكتور عن الصينيين وإنه هن عرفوا عن الصواريخ من 2000 سنة. فالسؤال إنه كيف عرفوا عن الصيني، كيف عرفوا عن الصواريخ من 2000 سنة؟ شو كانوا عم يدرسوا حتى قدروا يعرفوا شيء عنها؟ وين كانوا عم بيحاولوا يروحوا؟ This question is in Arabic. The question about the Chinese, the Chinese knew about the rockets for like 2000 years ago. So like how did they know about that? And where were they trying to go? Like, yeah, why were they interested in such a thing?
So, the Chinese knew about rockets, and they, but as with all things, unfortunately, as we've seen through the lecture today, a lot of what pushes science is warfare. And rockets weren't that useful in warfare. They you could fire them, but they didn't really know where they were going to land. They weren't that useful, and it took a lot of resources to make a rocket. So actually, rockets, gunpowder rockets like this, were only really used for fireworks. Okay, it sounds bizarre. And they didn't really, the idea of guns and cannons, that also didn't quite work. There was a lot of issues around that. Basically, they weren't very good weapons of war. And because of that, that research wasn't conducted into that area. I hope, does that make sense, Nazeer?
Yeah, exactly. So they were trying to like develop or like to use them in war and trying to develop them. That was the main.
Yes, but the rockets would just go everywhere. Obviously, unfortunately, you want them to hit your enemy. Yes. And because the rockets would just fly everywhere, they weren't very useful.
All right. طيب فهون عم بيقول طبعا اهتمامهم بالصواريخ الحقيقه الصينيين وللاسف كان اهتمامهم فقط هو لانه تساعدهم بالحرب، يعني هذا كان اهتمامهم بالصواريخ، هذا السبب اهتمام، هذا السبب الرئيسي. الصواريخ بهذيك الفتره ما كانت مفيده لانه كانوا بيعرفوا يطلقوها بس ما كان من السهل انه يوجهوها، ما كان يعرف وين بدها تروح. فكان محاولة دراسته هو لمحاولة انه استخدامه في الحرب، انه يحاولوا يقدروا يستخدموها في الحرب لاحقا. I think that was the question, right?
Yes, yeah, that was it. Thank you. Yes.
Yeah, right. So we'll move to the next question too. Why haven't we been back to the moon for so long?
Right.
All right, so I'll also say this question in Arabic. في سؤال هون انه طبعا كمان مر بالمحاضره انه نحن اخر مره رجعنا على القمر 1972، فليش ما رجعنا على القمر من هذاك الوقت؟ So back to you, Dr. Simon.
Okay. Firstly, so I'll restart, sorry. So, unlike the Earth, the Moon doesn't have a magnetic field, and neither does Mars. Now, this is incredibly important because the Sun is constantly letting out streams of radiation. On Earth, this radiation is pushed around the planet by the magnetic field. But on the moon, without a magnetic field, the radiation hits the surface and anything on it, including astronauts. So that's the first part, Nazeer.
Right. طيب طيب الجواب هلا أول شيء القمر أو حتى المريخ ما في عندهم مجال مغناطيسي مثل الأرض. الأرض في حولها مجال مغناطيسي. هذا الشيء مهم الحقيقة المجال المغناطيسي. لشو مهم؟ لأنه الشمس بتطلق حقل مغناطيسي وموجات كهرومغناطيسية كهربائية مغناطيسية دوما. هلا هاي الموجات لما بتجي على الأرض، الأرض بمجال المغناطيسي بتسيطر عليهم أو فبيروحوا حول الأرض بيصيروا ما بيأثروا عليهم، ولكن القمر والمريخ لما بتجيهم الموجات فبتجي موجات ما في مجال مغناطيسي للقمر لأنه يحمي حاله أو يحمي اللي عليه من هاي الموجات. Back to you, Dr. Simon.
Thank you. So normally this isn't too much of a problem, but occasionally the sun can have a storm and it can have something called a solar flare. Now these are ejected out into space, and when they hit the earth, they cause the aurora. The magnetic field pushes, the magnetic field of the earth pushes that radiation down to the north and south pole, and you get the aurora. On the moon, without a magnetic field, this huge blast of radiation would hit the planet, or hit the satellite, hit the moon. And some of these blasty solar flares for astronauts would be fatal instantly.
Wow.
So we have to, when Americans first went to the moon, we didn't understand this and they took a huge risk. They were very lucky. But now we do know this, we have to bear this in mind. So and there's more, sorry. But yeah, I'll go there. Sorry, Nazeer.
It's fine, but it's like, yeah, it's interesting how they just like lucked out and just like,
yeah.
All right. طيب فالحقيقة بيقول طبعا الموجات الكهرومغناطيسية اللي عم تطلقها الشمس ما هي المشكلة؟ المشكلة انه احيانا بيصير في عاصفة شمسية، يعني هدول الموجات بيصيروا قوية جدا بنسميها عاصفة شمسية. هاي العاصفة الشمسية اللي هي عبارة عن اشعاعات مغناطيسية بتطلع من الشمس. هلا لما نكون احنا على الارض، الارض بقطبين الشمالي والجنوبي بالأقطاب المغناطيسية اللي إلها بالحقل المغناطيسي اللي إلها ممكن يتشكل عنا الهالة أو الشيء، يعني هذا الإشعاع يصير حول الأرض وبالتالي ما يأثر على الأشخاص الموجودين على الأرض. ولكن على القمر إذا أجت العاصفة الشمسية راح تضرب القمر، وهي العاصفة إذا كانت قوية بتكون مميتة. يعني إذا كان في حدا على القمر بوقت حدوث عاصفة شمسية يعني هذا بيشكل خطر كبير عليه، وإذا كان عاصفة شمسية قوية فرح يموت الشخص الموجود على القمر لأنه ما في حقل مغناطيسي للقمر يحميه من العاصفة الشمسية. قال كمان الدكتور إنه لما طلعوا على القمر ما كنا بنعرف لسه عن موضوع العواصف الشمسية، يعني فقط كنا محظوظين بأنه رواد الفضاء لما كانوا على القمر ما صار عاصفة شمسية، ما كان في عاصفة شمسية بهذاك الوقت، بس لو كان هذا أكيد يعني عمل أشياء، أكيد كان أذى رواد الفضاء الموجودين هناك. So back to you, Dr. Simon.
Okay, thank you. So this is actually also the reason, or part of the reason, we've yet to go to Mars, because the journey to Mars will be at least 9 months. And on the way to Mars, there is a good chance that the spacecraft could be hit by one of these solar storms, these solar flares. And sometimes they might be mild, but sometimes they could be severe. And if they're very severe, then it could cause big problems. It could be fatal for the astronauts. Also, the other big reason why human beings haven't been back to the moon and also onto Mars is cost. The cost, I think through the 1960s and the 1970s up until it stopped, the cost of the moon program was that for every $1 in tax that the American government took in, 25%, 25 cents, a quarter of it, was spent on the space program. So a quarter of the American budget was just spent on the space program. It simply wasn't sustainable. Can you imagine a quarter of your money going on something like that when people may have no food, may not have healthcare? That was the other main reason.
So the trip to the moon takes 9 months.
Oh, no, the trip to Mars takes 9 months. Oh, the trip to the moon takes maybe a week, maybe 2 weeks.
All right. طبعا عم بيقول هلا في ان كان الرحله للمريخ او للقمر بتاخذ وقت طويل. الرحله للقمر ممكن اسبوع او اسبوعين، الرحله للمريخ ممكن 9 شهور. فاثناء الرحله لما السفينه الفضائيه بالجو، اذا صار عاصفه شمسيه، هي العاصفه ممكن تكون مميته بتاثر، اذا او ممكن اذا كانت قويه اذا تاثر على رواد الفضاء. فهذا احد الاسباب، العواصف الشمسيه بتخلينا انه ننتبه كثير قبل ما نبعث رواد فضاء على القمر. السبب الثاني انه وقفت من هذيك الفتره انها كانت مكلفه جدا. فالبرنامج القمر كلف الحكومه الامريكيه ربع الدخل القومي. يعني كل دولار عم يندفع من الضرائب 25 سنت منه كان يروح لدعم برنامج القمر والذهاب إلى القمر. فطبعا يعني مع عدم وجود هالفوائد الكبيرة اللي بتقابل هذا المبلغ الضخم اللي إنه ينصرف، فالناس كانت تفضل إنه ينصرف المبلغ بقى على ربما دعم القطاعات الثانية، التعليم أو الطعام أو يعني أي قطاعات. يعني هذا إذن أحد الأسباب اللي خلى مشروع الذهاب إلى القمر يوقف، إنه أولاً الخطورة وثانياً الكلفة. So with these two reasons, I think we answered the question.
Yes.
All right. So we can go to the next question. طيب راح نروح للسؤال الثاني. لوين كان موجه أول صاروخ؟ So we have a question here. Where was the first rocket aimed at? Is that...
Sorry, am I okay to go, Nazeer?
Yeah, you can start.
Yeah. Unfortunately, the first proper rocket, which we saw in the clip, the V2, that was aimed at London. So Adolf Hitler wanted revenge. He wanted to scare the inhabitants of London and also Holland, because the Germans were retreating from Holland. So yes, it was aimed at London. And fortunately, many of them didn't land in London for various reasons, but a lot of it was, yeah, I won't go into too much detail, but basically, yeah, it was London. And yeah, it was very lucky, basically. Again, sorry, I should say, just like with the rocket that sent human beings to the moon, only the top part of the rocket actually contained any weapons. Most of it was fuel. So when they did land, they didn't make that big an explosion. It was more of a weapon of terror to scare people than actually to do harm.
All right. طيب فأول صاروخ تم إطلاقه لوين؟ يعني كان هذا السؤال إنه لوين تم إطلاق أول صاروخ؟ فأقول للأسف أول صاروخ تم إطلاقه بواسطة أدولف هتلر اللي أطلقه على لندن. أما لحسن الحظ إنه الصاروخ ما يعني صاب لندن. ولكن ايضا ايضا مثل ما شفتوا بالمحاضره انه معظم جسم الصاروخ عباره عن وقود، الصاروخ اللي بيحمل البشر صح، حتى الصاروخ اللي هو بيكون يستخدم في الحرب، فالقسم المتفجرات قسم الاسلحه هو بيكون كمان قسم صغير، معظم جسم الصاروخ بيكون عباره عن وقود. فاللي حسن الحظ انه حتى الصاروخ لما تم اطلاقه لما وقع بمكان قرب لندن ما عمل دمار كبير، وما كان عندهم قوة تدميرية كبيرة الصواريخ بهذاك الوقت، السبب انه معظم جسم الصاروخ كان لازم يكون وقود، فما كان في قوة تدميرية كبيرة، فاصلا ما كان الهدف منه التدمير قد ما كان الهدف منه هو إخافة العدو او إخافة الناس الموجودين في الطرف الآخر. Do you want to add anything to that, Dr. Simon?
I'm just trying to think. The first rockets that were used, I suppose, peacefully, were ones that sent satellites into space, like Sputnik. So they were the first ones that used, and that was at the end of the 1950s, and they were the ones that that were peaceful, if that makes sense.
All right. أما إذا بدنا نحكي عن أول صاروخ تم إطلاقه، فتم إطلاق أول صاروخ سلمي تم إطلاقه فبالخمسينيات القرن الماضي، إطلاق الصاروخ سبوتنيك للفضاء، هذا كان هو صاروخ سلمي تم إطلاقه. So we get to go to the next question.
Yes, please. Sorry. Yeah, please. Sorry, I didn't make that very cheerful. Sorry.
طيب راح نروح للسؤال الثاني. السؤال بيقول إنه هل في طرق تانية لنروح على الفضاء بدون استخدام الصواريخ؟ Are there other ways? Are there other ways to get to space without using a rocket?
Yes. There are. I thought I'd put it in the talk and I may have taken it out for time. Okay, so sorry. One way of getting into space is using a weather balloon. Now that sounds peculiar. Okay, so this is a very good question actually. So weather balloons, you may have seen that you can launch them and they basically get to the edge of space. And one person, the Americans, Let's just say, yes, you can use a weather balloon to get to the edge of space. And then I'll complete that. Okay, thank you. Sorry, Nazeer.
Sure. طبعا بيقول في طريقة تانية لأنه نروح على الفضاء بدون استخدام الصاروخ، نستخدم شيء تاني اللي هو نستخدم البالون أو بالون الطقس بيسموه. فممكن نستخدم البالون لحتى نوصل للفضاء. وطبعا شرح شوي الدكتور عن كيف الامريكان استخدموا البالون لوصول الفضاء، بس قال انه راح يرجع يشرح هذا الشيء بشكل شوي مفصل. We can use the balloon to go to space and
The Americans were having trouble launching rockets, satellites and astronauts into space. So they took a weather balloon and its platform, removed all of the weather equipment and actually placed a human being in there. And his name was Joe Kittinger. And he went to the edge of space 3 times. And when he got to the edge of space, he jumped off and came back. As I say, he did that 3 times. And he basically technically was the first human being to go into space. Actually, he was above 99% of the atmosphere. So there are kind of cheating ways of getting into space. There's one more. So I'll ask her if you, sorry, Nazeer, if you do that, and then I'll give you one more after that, okay?
Yes. Yeah, and this is, by the way, our last question.
Okay.
طيب هلا نحن بدنا طبعا بالنسبه لاستخدام البالون، طبعا كان اول شيء استخدام الصواريخ في صعوبه فيه، فجربوا ايضا استخدام البالون اللي عملوه البالون اللي كان يستخدم للطقس شالوا تجهيزات الطقس منه ووضعوا بداله إنسان دخل إنسان مكانه ركب هذا البالون وطلع تقريبا لآخر الغلاف الجوي وبعدين نزل من هونيك ترك البالون ونزل من هونيك الشخص اللي عمله اسمه جون هذا الشخص قدر يعمل هاي المحاولة 3 مرات وكان تقريبا هو الشخص اللي بيطلع لهالمسافة هاي بالبالون Back to you, Dr. Simon.
So one other way is to actually build an elevator into space. And this has got a lot of interest. So we could use carbon. Carbon fiber can build very long structures and very strong structures. And the idea is that we will build effectively a giant elevator into space. And this is how we could launch satellites. You'd basically just push them up, lift them up on the elevator and they get to the top and you would just push them off the top and they would go into orbit. And that is a, that's an idea that crops up every now and again. So that is still out there. So yes, it's called the space elevator. And can I add one last thing? Sorry, Nazeer. If the students are interested, I actually cover a lot of this in the, I've recorded a video for the Launchpad Challenge. And they can enter, I'm sure all these students will do very well in the Phoenix Launchpad Challenge because they've done some amazing questions. Sorry. That was it. Sorry, that was my plug as well for the other thing. Sorry, Nazeer. Thank you very much.
Yeah, it's fine. So just like to get this right, so the elevator, it's an idea still.
Yes, but people are trying it. Basically, carbon fiber is things that racing cars are made out of. It's very strong and you can make huge long structures out of it. It's a bit like, well, I shouldn't say spaghetti, but you can make huge long structures that are incredibly strong. Yeah. And the idea is that you would make one that went into space and you could just winch your satellites, your objects up, and then they'd just fly off the end into space. So you wouldn't need a rocket.
Yeah, it hasn't been done yet, but we're close to that. Or like the idea.
People are trying it. Yes, people. There are experiments, so it's in the experimental phase, but people are trying it.
Right. طبعا الطريقة الثانية لأنه نوصل للفضاء بدون استخدام صواريخ هي طريقة حاليا عم يتم دراستها وحتى في تجارب عليها بأنه نعمل مصعد. هذا المصعد بياخذنا طبعا. مو للفضاء ولكن لمكان عالي جدا نطلع بالمصعد بمكان عالي بعدين بالسرعة اللي نحن فيها اللي بنوصلها بنهاية المصعد ننطلق وهذا الإطلاق ممكن يكون كافي لأنه نطلع فيه على الفضاء طبعا كفكرة مثل هاي هي ممكن تستخدم لإطلاق الأقمار الصناعية فبدل ما نستخدم الصواريخ لإطلاق الأقمار الصناعية ممكن أنه نستخدم المصاعد هالمصاعد الفضائية ممكن نسميها فبهالمصعد بينحط القمر الصناعي بينعطى سرعة كبيرة بحيث لما يوصل لنهاية المصعد يكون معه سرعة كبيرة يقدر يكمل فيها لمداره اللي لازم يدور عليه بالفضاء طبعا عم بيقول إذا مهتمين بهذا الموضوع الدكتور سايمون في حط فيديو على موقع المسابقة اللي عملتها فينيكس سبيس واللي كلكم طبعا مدعوين لأنه تشاركوا فيها بس تدخلوا على موقع فينيكس سبيس فيكم تلاقوا رابط المسابقة فيكم تشاركوا فيها وفيكم أيضا تعودوا كمان تشوفوا الفيديو اللي حطوا فيه معلومات عن الشيء اللي حكينا So thank you Dr. Simon
Thank you
and Alex Hey
Hi. Yeah, I just wanted to jump in and say a few closing remarks, and I was just hoping that you could translate them as well. So,
of course.
First, I'd just like to thank on behalf of the attendees and also Phoenix Space, Dr. Foster, for once again donating his time and expertise to what has been an absolutely fantastic lecture. I've been trying to keep up with answering the questions behind the scenes. There are so many, and they're fantastic questions. So we will try to get these answered in one way or another, either with Dr. Foster in some sort of follow-up video, or we might just take some of them and just put them on the social media, on the Instagram. So if the attendees would like to follow us on Instagram and Facebook, and we will try and answer them. Nazeer, could you just translate that, and then I'll talk about the launch pad very briefly.
Of course. طبعا أليكس بس حاب أول شيء طبعا يشكركم على الحضور يشكر دكتور سالمون على وجوده معنا وأيضا هو اللي كان عم يجاوبكم على الأسئلة في كثير طبعا كانوا عم يحطوا أسئلة فطبعا ما قدرنا نأخذ كل الأسئلة كان هذا آخر سؤال نقدر نأخذه ولكن أليكس حاول يجاوب على بعض الأسئلة لو عندكم أسئلة تانية طبعا فيكم تحطوها على الانستغرام على حسابنا الانستغرام هلا بطلع على الشاشة وأيضا طبعا الأسئلة اللي ما تم الإجابة عليها راح ينبعث لكم إجابة عليها لاحقا. So back to you, Alex.
Thank you, Nazeer. So the last thing I'd like to just share with all the attendees is that Phoenix Space is launching a competition on our website. And this is open to all students from ages 15 to 19. And they have to submit the an idea for a solution to a problem based on settling Mars. There are prizes up for grabs. You have to present your idea to a panel of experts. And there is a possibility to win an award, to win cash, to win some educational prizes, and also be featured on our website. So they can go to the Phoenix Space website and sign up there. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. طيب طبعا هون أليكس بس كمان حب يحكي لكم عن المسابقة اللي موجودة على موقع Phoenix Space. فيكم تروحوا على على اللينك اللي موجود بالموقع. وتحاولوا تسجلوا على المسابقة المسابقة هي عن إيجاد مشكلة للعيش في المريخ وحل له فطبعا يعني فيكم تشوفوا شروط المسابقة وكل شيء عن المسابقة هوني المسابقة طبعا يعني فيها جوائز مادية قيمة وأيضا فيها يعني جوائز علمية فإذا حبيتوا تشاركوا فيكم بس تروحوا لهنيك تحطوا اسمكم وبعدين ممكن تطوروا الفكرة اللي راح تشتغلوا عليها وبعد هيك بتقدروا بقى طبعا في بعدها في موجهين ممكن يساعدوكم بتطوير الحلول اللي اشتغلتوها طيب فهذا كان كل شيء لليوم شكرا لوجودكم معنا طبعا هي نهاية محاضرتنا اليوم شكرا لكل اللي عم يحضروا لكل اللي شاركوا شكرا ايضا دكتور سايمون اجابته على الاسئله لو مثل ما حكينا لكم لو عندكم اي اسئله ممكن تبعتوها على الانستغرام واكيد الفريق راح يجاوبكم عليها طبعا بعد المحاضره راح يكون في استبيان صغير يا ريت الكل يقدر ينضم يقدر يجاوب على هذا الاستبيان بس طلعتوا هلا بس عملتوا ليف عملتوا خروج من المحاضره رح تلاقوا في استبيان بيطلع لكم بعض بضع اسئله بياخذ منكم يعني وقت كثير قليل فحاولوا تقدروا تجاوبوا عليها مشان نقدر نعرف رايكم عن المحاضره وبنشوفكم ان شاء الله بمحاضره الجاي So as our time today is coming to an end, I'd like to thank you all for participating in our lecture event. Thank you, Dr. Simon, for answering our students' questions. If you have any further questions or your question wasn't answered today, please post your questions at our Instagram page and the Phoenix team will address all of them. After the lecture is finished, you will see a short survey on your screen. Please take 1 minute to fill it out. We'd love to know your opinion. See you at our next lecture. Thank you, Dr. Simon.
Thank you.